So my name is Luca, Luca Bruno actually. I work on Container Linux team, so we take care of the OS, the distribution itself, and most of the links around it. So as you all know, Container Linux was previously called CoreOS. It's a distribution based on Gentoo, and it comes with auto updates out of the box. And then on top of that, we also develop a bunch of tools, basically to provide a seamless experience on cloud environment and in order to properly run cluster, especially Kubernetes cluster. I also work on Rocket. It was my main and only task before, and now I'm multitasking about it. What I will do today is a very, very short talk, which is not getting into too many technical details, but the idea is basically to just showcase and point out some tools that are typically not that much known. But if you are into operation, in general, if you care about Linux system, you may want to check and you may actually enjoy. So yeah, it's not going to be too long. And I'm going to point out basically to these tools. There is a short list. And they take care of several small tasks, let's say. In the old tradition, we basically built many components and then we tried to glue them together in order to provide a working experience out of the box. Some of those components are strictly related to the operating system, to Container Linux. Some other, they are more or less like valid and you can port them to other distributions. Like if you want to run them even on Fedora, they should work. Some other are more like network and infrastructure side. And some other of these are more like plugins for other tools that you use every day. So I'm going to start from the first one. The first one is Ignition. Ignition is some kind of recent tool that we wrote. It's actually a replacement for some other tools that already existed. The first one was the typical Cloud Init, so the one from Canonical, which is taking care of configuring your instance when it is booted on some cloud environment, typically on Amazon or Azure or Google Cloud. It takes some user data from somewhere and then applies some changes. The first iteration of that was Cloud Init from Canonical, which is written in Python. The second iteration of that was basically a replacement, a one-to-one replacement that we wrote in Go, basically in order to remove all the dependencies from Python and make it a bit more like compact as part of the Container Linux image. But we faced some issues. So when we wrote that, we didn't put too much care on the design or thinking about it actually. And we figured out later that there are several problems with the Cloud Init as it is typically designed. And the main problem is that you are trying to configure an instance which is already up. And in that situation, you basically hit races everywhere. So you try to configure the network, but in order to do that, you already need a network. And then you restart the network, and then some other components which started and they require the network, now they are failing. Or you try to configure Docker, but Docker is already started because you need it for something else. So these kind of issues, which are basically some chickens, they keep going on and on. We hit several of those, and then we realized that basically the whole design, the whole approach was a bit wrong. So what we did is trying to, we did something which was a bit painful, but quite necessary, which is rewriting and actually redesigning and re-architecting this component. This is how Ignition came to life. So Ignition does the same things at Cloud Init. It takes some user data, some configuration file, and then it provision and configure a machine, but it does it in a different way. The other problem that I didn't mention is that Cloud Init always runs on every single boot, so you actually can use it to reconfigure a machine. And then you end up in some situation where you start with some configuration, then you change it, and then it got mixed in a way. So when we re-architectured Ignition, what we did instead is we moved this component very early in the boot. We actually moved it into the init RAM. So at that point, the machine is still not up. We can still do a lot of things. And on top of that, Ignition is only running once. This is basically to reach this definition of immutable infrastructure. What we do is we provision the Ignition exactly once, your machine, the first time that it is booted or created, and then on every subsequent boot, nothing changed, and you are sure that your infrastructure is always the same. In that way, basically by moving it into the internet and only doing it on the first boot, we can manage to do many more things, but much more things compared to before, so now we can also partition disk, we can mount volumes and do this kind of stuff that are then required by other components when they are booting, like for the network or for Docker or their other services, which is cool, which is actually what a lot of people need when they are setting up their AWS instance with some specific, I don't know, RAID configuration or multi-disk or partitioning or whatever. Another interesting thing from Ignition is that instead of taking YAML, it takes some JSON input. This JSON input is actually a version, and there is a schema that we publish, and so you always know which kind of option you have and which one is the current schema. So we keep adding feature, and we try not to break the previous one by giving you this kind of tile configuration, version configuration. And on top of that, it can also fetch some more assets from the network. So it's like you have this user data, which typically on Amazon is limited to 16K. If you want to download more stuff or add more configuration into that, you can include further configuration and you can fetch assets from the network. And this is Ignition. A bunch of cool new features, so things that we are actively working in the last month, let's say, is that recently Ignition gained support for S3 directly, which means, let me take a step back. There was one use case which we were not covering, and this use case was I'm booting some instance, I want to configure it, but there are some private assets that I need to fetch, like some keys or certificates or secrets or passwords or tokens or whatever, and they are on some S3 buckets. And these S3 buckets, they have a proper IAM policy, so they are configured so only certain instances can fetch from them. But Ignition didn't know about all this stuff, so it was not aware of anything. And there were some configuration where basically we were not supporting it. So now we can directly fetch from S3. Another things that we added recently, so Ignition supports most of the cloud environments, so the usual one that you can think about, they are already supported. And now we are porting to some other platform that are typically used for like local testing and demos and development. In this case, something that got implemented this month is support for Vagrant and VirtualBox. This is like, expect soon some kind of demo, a better integrated demo via Vagrant and VirtualBox. And then the final stuff is, as I mentioned before, this takes some YAML, this takes some JSON configuration while the previous Cloud Native component was taking YAML. Some people are really confused about what should I put as a configuration for my machine. Well, we have a tool online which is a validator, so in case you are confused and you have no idea what you are doing, you just copy paste your file there and it will tell you it's valid, it's not valid, you are supposed to use something else, so you are completely confused about what you are trying to do, and giving some hints about what is the proper way of doing that. That said, I know that writing JSON is never fun. Everybody knows. The reason why we went for JSON is that this is a low-level tool which takes data and it shouldn't be ambiguous. In YAML there are some fields, for example numerical or octal or things like that, or true and false, which can become quite a pain to manage, and they are a bit ambiguous to parse. And so at the low level we take JSON. Still, it's quite hard to write JSON. So there is another tool which basically sits on top of Ignition, but in a different place, which is called the Configuration Transpiler. So this is like a human-friendly companion to Ignition. Ignition is running on your machine, it takes this JSON input and does some stuff. But then on the other side, you as a user, as an admin, you don't want to write JSON. So you basically can write your similar to Cloud Init YAML, so something which is much more human-friendly. And then you have CT, which is a tool that you can run on your laptop or whatever operating system you have, which takes this YAML as an input and then produce some Ignition configuration on the other side. Let's say CT is interesting not only because of this YAML to JSON translation, because it's quite simple to do, it also takes care of adding some more logic. So while with Ignition you are supposed to configure every single details that you want to provision your machine, with CT you can specify some higher level configuration, like I want some etcd service and there are exactly three other nodes in this etcd cluster, and these are the nodes in a YAML configuration, and then it will basically generate the appropriate service drop-in for an issue to use. That's the repository. We call it CT. In reality, it has a very human unfriendly name, which is Container Linux Config Transpiler, just because we never managed to come up with a proper name. That's one of the other problems in computer science. Then the next one. The next one is called Redis Metadata. This is a service that I guess it has always been provided as part of Container Linux. Not so many people know about it, so I'm pointing it out now. This basically takes care of when you are booting, when this service is starting, it takes care of fetching metadata from the usual metadata endpoint in a cloud provider and exposing it as a simple file, which is a key equal value file. In that way, it's quite smart because we run it once and then we provide it as a drop-in environment file for other services like for etcd or any other things that require some network performance. And in that way, basically we are gluing together again some components. This one takes care of writing down, for example, what is a public IP, what is a private IP, which region you're in, what's the name of the instance, and some other information, metadata like that. And again, you can source this via environment file directly in systemd units, so you don't have to code the same logic in every single tool that you're using. And this is actually portable across different cloud providers. So it's like the same service units, the same application which is consuming this metadata file will work on Azure, on Google Cloud, on AWS, or even others. And it also takes care, of course, of syncing SSH keys from your configuration in the cloud provider to the instance. But the URL is wrong. It's coreos-metadata. Sorry. Another one that I want to talk about is Torx. This is really, really new. It's basically the latest new tool that we are developing. It's still in alpha stage, so it's not available on stable and on beta, only on alpha. The idea here is that in some cases, for example, in a Kubernetes cluster, you want to auto-update your machine, so you want to always use the latest version, the latest patch and release. But you have some components that are very specific and they are sensible to version updates, for example, Docker. This is a bit unfortunate in the sense that we ship very few components in Container Linux, but some of those are dependencies for others. Docker is another dependency for Kubernetes. And we cannot arbitrarily change Docker version behind the hood of Kubernetes, otherwise the cluster will not work properly. So the idea here is we kind of lack some tool which is complementary to Ignition. So Ignition is only running on the first boot, but at some point we also need some other tool which is able to apply configuration in a recurrent way that can be updated after boots. How we do this is via this Torx, which is a systemd generator, but quite an unconventional one. This systemd generator is running very early in the boot, after Ignition, so after the init RD is done, but when the machine is already booting. And it takes care of basically checking what the administrator wants. So you can specify some profile saying, I want this specific Docker version, or I don't want Docker at all. And then Torx is just taking care of basically unpacking the proper Docker version. This is still alpha because right now we basically ship a single version of Docker and we don't have all the process, all the tooling around it to let you actually pick which Docker version you want to use, but this is on our roadmap. What else? All the changes that it applies are ephemeral, so like when you reboot, they are gone. And the goal again, it is kind of multi-purpose, so you can do your own configuration that way. But our goal, our idea was basically to provide something to let you pick the Docker version because this is the most critical component that you may want to pick. Another one with a very non-human friendly name is Clue. We call it Clue because otherwise it's too long. This is part of our Kubernetes and Tectonic offering, so it's an operator, in the sense of Kubernetes operator. And it takes care of managing updates to the Container Linux instance. The idea is, so far we were shipping Locksmith, which is this component, which is always like, which is always running on a node and takes care of checking if there are updates and actually defining some maintenance windows when you can update and then running the updates. Now we are moving this a bit to a higher level, so with better integration with Kubernetes itself. So this glue is actually made of two components. There is one real operator, so something which is Kubernetes aware and takes care of the higher level of orchestration of upgrades. And then there is a node local agent, which is the replacement of Locksmith, which takes care of actually rebooting the machine when the operator asks for it. Sorry, updating and rebooting the machine. In this way, basically, we can get upgrades across a cluster of nodes, which are part of Kubernetes, and all of these managed via some Tectonic dashboard, the usual Kubernetes logic and kubectl commands. This is again, this is something that we did recently, not that much, so it was some months ago, but we are still working on it, so it's not yet 100% feature parity with Locksmith. And we are getting there, and we are adding some more stuff, like some ways for you to actually provide some pre-reboot and post-reboot hooks, so some kind of action that you can actually schedule when the node is being rebooted, before rebooting and after rebooting. Yep. So the next one instead is Meshbox. Meshbox existed before with a different name that right now I don't remember.
BootCFG.
What?
BootCFG.
Correct. This was the name last year, if not wrong, and a bit expanded on what it wants to do. The idea is this provides a single toolbox. I don't know how to describe it, but let's say a single solution for all your PXC and netbooting needs, which is kind of modern in the sense that it also supports more advanced constructs like templates and grouping machine and selecting machine and things like that. This is basically what we use internally for provisioning bare metal clusters. Because in typical bare metal environments, you are missing a lot of those features that are offered by your cloud provider or APIs and points. So you cannot introspect your machine, you cannot choose which machine is part of which group and what they are supposed to do. And this is actually the goal of Meshbox. And it offers several endpoints, and it is typically used together with chain loading and IBC. And then I think this is the last one. So far there were mostly tools that we wrote from scratch, but in several cases, we reuse components that we've written as somebody else, or we just add plugins in order to support some specific feature that we need. In this case, if you are into operation, you probably already know about Terraform, which is a tool written by HashiCorp, which takes care of provisioning your cloud infrastructure across multiple cloud providers. So you declare, you specify a declarative configuration how your infrastructure should look, and then Terraform takes care of applying this configuration. And you can do that in AWS, Azure, or whatever else. We actually like it a lot. That's how our Tectonic Kubernetes installer is written. It's completely based on Terraform. And on top of that, what was missing was basically some components which was providing gluing between our tools, so the low-level tools that I showed before, and this higher level Terraform logic. So what we wrote in this case is basically two providers. The first one is gluing between Terraform and Meshbox, so you can actually provision most of these bare metal clusters. And the other one is some gluing between Terraform and CT. And this is basically used to go from a Terraform configuration to the real configuration for your instance. And there was a bit of debate here, so we can also have some kind of Terraform provider for Ignition. The idea is that we don't want to expose Ignition too much to the user. That's what we use under the hood. But debugging, as I learned myself the other way, debugging Ignition issues, it's quite hard. It's much easier to have some kind of higher level tools in front of it to help you and to stop you before making mistakes. and which is why we are going from Terraform to CT, and then that one is generating the initial configuration. And that's it. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something new. I don't know if you are already aware of all these tools. They may be useful. You typically don't use all of them together, but for some specific task, I have to say that when I learned about new tools, new specific solving tools, I was quite amazed by the offering that we have and the fact that we can fit in several places small tools to bridge the gap. That's it. Thank you. I didn't ask. Do you have questions?
So which of these tools is one most likely to have to actually do something with personally, like interface with, and which ones are kind of happen behind the scenes?
So it depends on the definition of view. So if let's say that I would probably rank them in this way. If you have some kind of hardcore, or let's say somebody that don't like too much automation and you want to write your configuration yourself, you will probably step into CT. So it's like at some point you will have to write your configuration by hand, and it's going to be some YAML file, and that one is going to translate to JSON for Ignition. You definitely don't want to directly touch into Ignition because that's a world of pain. With Torx, right now the idea is that this is going to be handled by some higher level operator inside Kubernetes Tectonic. So you typically will not have to switch yourself the version of components that you're going to use, but it's going to be orchestrated by some operator who already knows which Kubernetes version is running, which container version is running, and this kind of information. Matchbox, it depends. If you are bare metal, I strongly suggest to have a look at that, because it's quite useful. It provides a lot of features that you are otherwise missing. And it's also like, I have to say I'm not a big bare metal aficionado, but from what I've seen from user, every time they discover Matchbox, they say, oh, that's lovely, that's exactly what I was missing. So my understanding is that it works really well and it solves a real problem, but again, I don't have that much experience in that field. Regarding Terraform, it depends. If you are already buying into, Terraform plugins, it depends. If you are already buying into the whole Terraform story, it's definitely helpful, both on environmental and not. Otherwise, it's choice. So it's like, if you don't like Terraform, you never use it. That's it, I guess. The CoreOS metadata, you are using it already under the hood most of the time. When you are using it, CD, for example, it is already sourcing some configuration from there in most of the cases. And it is helpful in general when you don't want to repeat yourself and you don't want to call some cloud-specific logic in every single application that you have. That's it. I would say the one that you will probably experience the most soon will be Clua, because that's going to be part of every single Kubernetes cluster running on top of container Linux. So if it works, it's going to be great. When it doesn't work, you know who to blame. And so that's it.
Question? Like for Torx and Clua, will this also work if I run my own Kubernetes, or will it only work well in conjunction with Tectonic?
So Torx is part of the operating system. Clua is an open source operator, so you can technically run it yourself. The thing is, right now we have multiple operators which are kind of like intermediate level, let's say. I kind of consider Clua in this intermediate level operator, and also the KVO, the Kubernetes version operator, to be somehow intermediate. Because then on top of that, we have another component, which is the Tectonic one, which actually knows about, there is a new Tectonic version, and this new Tectonic version has a new Kubernetes version. And this is actually a major Kubernetes version, and this is incompatible with some Docker version. And then you need to actually download or unpack a different Torx add-on. So this is like, every single component you can use it, it's open source, it's cheap, there is documentation, whatever. It's just that it's quite easy to get things wrong. So for example, managing Torx packages and Kubernetes version, you may think about using two operator in a standalone separate way, but then when you are updating the operating system without updating Kubernetes or vice versa, you can end up in incompatibilities. And that's why we basically demanded to an higher level to solve this kind of incompatibility. So we already know that there's going to be some cases that we don't support, like running a very old Kubernetes version on a very new operating system or vice versa. In that case, the operator will just tell you there is a mismatch. If you don't have this kind of higher level logic either, you know, so you have the knowledge yourself and you know how not to step into this situation, or it's quite easy to make mistakes. This is in general for all the operators that we have. They work already, you can deploy, you can use them. We document how to do it. But again, if you step into something that is like, it's not supposed to work that way, it's typically because we have some higher level logic which takes care of not stepping into this situation. So I would not suggest it. And again, Tectonic is free for up to 10 nodes. So if you are in 10, let's say, small area, small size, why not? Other questions? No. Okay. I will leave it for 4 months.